Let's just worship the Lord this morning. He is good to us, and it's through His love that we can continue to be the hope for the world around us. Let's just sing of that this morning. Love is patient, love is kind, does not envy nor boast, it is not arrogant or rude, or demand its own way, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrong, it will not rejoice in evil, but rejoices with the truth.
Back in.
truth and justice shines like the sun in all of His brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love that You would take my place.
These elements with a heart that is right with God. So as we sing, just come and partake of the elements when you're ready.
In case you missed, there are elements both in the back and the front today, so you can head toward the back or toward the front so you can stay socially distanced.
Jesus. Sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
We pray that you would give us ears to hear, just hearts to understand. Lord, that your Spirit would just indwell us in a way that we would learn more of you this morning. That we would know your truth and that we could live by it. That we could see this world changed one life at a time through your love. Lord, just thank you for this place, Pastor Dan, as he comes and shares. In Jesus' name, amen.
And children, you would be dismissed to kids' church. Best of you can grab your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Habakkuk. Habakkuk is on page 829. I'll bet it's not the case for most of you, but for me it is. Anyway, it comes right after Nahum. A little bit before the New Testament. So, let me ask you a question. Do you have any questions that you would like to ask God? Like, how old is the earth? A lot of people argue about that. How old is the earth? Or, why do giraffes have such long necks? God, did you like make a mistake with them or something? Or, why in the world did you create mosquitoes? Yeah. Is there any redeeming factor in mosquitoes? I don't know. I don't think so. Were there dinosaurs on the ark? Lots of these questions you might want to ask God. Or maybe even some more serious ones, like why is there so much evil in the world and suffering in the world? Or why do good people suffer and evil people prosper? You know, the most common questions for God center around things like what if, how long, how come, or why? Well, the prophet Habakkuk has a couple questions for God. How long? And how could you? We're working our way through the minor prophets, minor in length, but major in message. And we come to the book of Habakkuk. Habakkuk, I've entitled Questions of Faith. He had a couple questions that kind of rattled his faith a little bit, but God answers his questions, and in the end, Habakkuk rejoices in the Lord. So let's set the stage for this study in Habakkuk. Verse 1, the oracle that Habakkuk the prophet received. Not much of a stage to set there, is there? Who is this prophet Habakkuk? Well, the truth is, Habakkuk is a bit of a mystery. We know very, very little about him, less than most of the other prophets. He's not mentioned anywhere else in the Bible. Although there are a few clues in his book, but we know nothing about his family and we know nothing about his hometown as well. We don't even know the meaning of Habakkuk's name, like we do most other prophets. Some suggest there's a link to the Hebrew verb kabak, which means to embrace, but the truth is we really don't know if there's a link to that or not. We don't really know much about him as a person. So what about the setting? Well, we do know that Habakkuk is a prophet to the nation of Judah, the southern nation. But it doesn't mention any particular kings in Judah, so it's very difficult to date him. But again, like I said, there are a few clues in the book that will help us understand when he's prophesying. For one thing, he's very concerned about the moral decline in the nation of Judah. It seems to be, also, that this is after the Assyrian conquest of Israel in 712 BC, because there's no mention of Israel, and there's no mention of Assyria anywhere as well. And it seems to be before the Babylonian conquest of Judah, which began in 605 BC, because it's a prophecy about Babylon judging, God using Babylon to judge Judah. And so, perhaps even before Babylon was considered a world empire. And so some people place him during the time of, well, most likely that places him sometime in the 7th century BC. Some people place him in the time of King Manasseh, one of the most wicked kings in Judah. That would certainly make, he was in the mid-7th century, and that would make sense when you think about the moral decline in Judah at that time. Others place him during King Josiah, who led Judah in reforms and revivals, but that doesn't seem to fit the picture of moral decline in Judah. And so I suggest it's probably best to place him around 610 to 605 BC, during the reign of King Jehoiakim, whom the Bible says, which has said this of many of the kings, but it says of Jehoiakim, he did evil in the eyes of the Lord. Even the prophet Jeremiah responded to Jehoiakim's godless reign with a prophecy of condemnation and a threat of Babylonian invasion of the southern two tribes of Judah. Just a little background here to kind of bring us up to Jehoiakim. Assyria overthrew Israel about 100 years before the suggested time that I suggest. Then there was a coalition of Babylon and the Medes and the Persians that overthrew Assyria, conquering the city of Nineveh in 612 BC. So that's about 7 years before, just a couple years before perhaps Habakkuk's time. And so at this time, Egypt is now the world threat. Pharaoh Necho has swept all the kings west of the Euphrates into his network of alliances, and so they were all paying tribute to the Pharaoh, or kind of a part of his alliance. In fact, the Pharaoh of Egypt, Pharaoh Necho, killed King Josiah, the king of Judah, at a battle in Megiddo, and then deposed the next king of Judah and set up his brother in his place. His brother happened to be King Jehoiakim. And even though Josiah had brought some revivals, King Jehoiakim kind of reversed all of those revivals and did evil in the sight of the Lord and led the nation in evil as well. In 605 BC, Babylon, after conquering Assyria in 612, now moves in and overthrows the Egyptian empire in a great battle called the Battle of Carchemish. And they launched the first attack on Jerusalem in 605 BC as well. And so Habakkuk seems to be prophesying very close to the time of Babylon's conquest of Egypt and their conquest of Judah as well. Chapters 1 and 2, the book's kind of easy to outline. Chapters 1 and 2, Habakkuk has a bit of a dialogue with God. He asks God two perplexing questions. And then in chapter 3, he responds to God with a prayer of praise and faith in his sovereign word. So we start the beginning with Habakkuk's dialogue with God. In chapter 1, we see a complaint or a question, and then God answers. That prompts a second complaint on Habakkuk's part, which God then answers in chapter 2. So let's start with Habakkuk's first complaint, verses 2 through 4 of chapter 1. How long? See, there's that phrase. How long? How long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen? Or cry out to you, violence, but you do not save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrong? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict to balance. Therefore, the law is paralyzed and justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteous so that justice is perverted. Basically, his complaint goes like this. How long, God, will you allow Judah's sin to go unpunished? It can be summed up really in the four words that he uses to describe Judah's situation. Violence, injustice, wrong, or we would call that sin or evil, and destruction. And those four words depict a society in Judah that is characterized by violence, cruel violence, by social injustice and oppression and exploitation of other people, by moral and spiritual sin, immorality and idolatry, and then a general spiritual and ethical havoc that is generated by all those other evils. And so in Habakkuk's eyes, Judah was spiritually bankrupt and morally corrupt. God's law was being ignored. It was no longer the guide for ethical and judicial decisions. The ungodly were perverting justice. Immorality and idolatry was running rampant in Israel. And so Habakkuk asked, God, how long? How can you turn a blind eye to your people's sin? How long can you let this go on, God? Why are you doing something about it? You can't just stand there and look on, can you, God? How long will you allow Judah's sin to go unpunished? Sometimes I wonder the same things about America. Do you? It's not just the immorality and the corruption and the social injustice and the violence and the persecution of the church and the blatant, outright rebellion against God. All that's bad enough. But how long will God let these evildoers go unpunished in America? How long can God be patient with America? How long can God let this go on? Ever wonder that? I sure do. I hope it's past my lifetime and past my grandkids' lifetime, but how long, oh Lord, how long? Well, God explains in verses 5 through 11. Let's read his explanation. He says to Habakkuk, look at the nations and watch and be utterly amazed. For I'm going to do something in your days that you would not believe, even if you were told. But then he proceeds to tell him, I am raising up the Babylonians, that ruthless and impetuous people who sweep across the whole earth to seize dwelling places not their own. They are a feared and dreaded people. They are a law to themselves and promote their own honor. Their horses are swifter than leopards, fiercer than wolves at dusk. Their cavalry gallops headlong. Their horsemen come from afar. They fly out like a vulture, swooping to devour. They all come bent on violence. Their hordes advance like a desert wind and gather prisoners like sand. They deride kings and scoff at rulers. They laugh at all fortified cities and build earthen ramps and capture them. Then they sweep past like the wind and go on. Guilty men, whose own strength is their God. Basically, God's answer is this. I am preparing Babylon to punish Judah. Habakkuk asks, how long can you let Judah's sin go unpunished? And God says, not much longer. I'm preparing Babylon to punish Judah. God starts by simply telling Habakkuk to look at the nations. And I suspect that Habakkuk probably starts to think about Assyria, who had defeated Israel 100 years before. And then he might start thinking about Babylon, who defeated Assyria, or maybe the Egyptians, who are now controlling Judah. But God says, not them. You're going to be utterly amazed. I'm about to do something that you won't even believe. And then he's very specific. I am preparing the Babylonians, the Chaldeans, to judge Judah. They are a fierce, cruel people in pursuit of world conquest. They have skilled military, the swift cavalry that can cover vast distances. Their army that advances as a unit and very swiftly, and they don't just put fortified cities under siege and wait for them, but they build ramps up to their top of their walls, and then they run over the walls and invade the city and destroy the city. And they just sweep across the country, the landscape, taking every city in their sight. They had conquered Nineveh in 612 BC. And now they're on the march across the world. Their next conquest was Carchemish. And then Jerusalem. God's answer to Habakkuk really emphasizes, I think, three truths that we need to understand that I think still apply to us today. First of all, that God is a righteous judge who is very much aware of everything that takes place in the world. He is not blind to sin. He's not blind to the wickedness of mankind. All sin will someday be judged and punished, even if it's the sin of his own people. God is righteous, God is just, and God will, in fact, judge sin. Second thing we learn is that God is sovereignly active in the affairs of history, in the affairs of the world. Even if it may not be evident to our human observation, But if we truly believe that God is sovereign, then our part is simply to trust God and let God be God in all of life's activities, including our nation. The third thing I think God's answer tells us is that God hears and answers prayer. It's not always the way we expect. It's not always the way we want Him to answer. But He always hears and He always answers prayer. See, we are finite beings, and we cannot understand the infinite ways of an infinite God, can we? Now, I think these truths apply to America and to our upcoming elections as well. We need to remember that God is God. He is just. He is sovereign. He is very much aware of the sin and corruption in our country, and He knows what's in, even in advance, He knows what's going to happen in our elections. And beyond this election, He knows. So our job is to pray and to trust that God hears and answers our prayers. He may not answer the way we want Him to, but He will hear and He will answer. Well, that answer by God kind of raises a little bit more concern in Habakkuk's mind, and so he has a second complaint in verses 12 through 22. He says, "O Lord, are you not from everlasting? My God, my Holy One, we will not die. O Lord, you have appointed them to execute judgment. O Rock, you have ordained them to punish. Your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrong. Why then do you tolerate the treacherous? Why are you silent while the wicked swallow up those more righteous than themselves? You have made men like fish in the sea, like sea creatures that have no ruler. The wicked foe pulls all of them up with hooks. He catches them in his net. He gathers them up in his dragnet, as though he rejoices and is glad. Therefore he sacrifices to his net, burns incense to his dragnet, for by his net he lives in luxury and enjoys the choicest food. Is he to come on emptying his net, destroying nations without mercy? I will stand on my watch and station myself on the ramparts. I will look to see what he will say to me and what answer I am to give to this complaint." So basically, what Habakkuk asks God here is, how in the world can you use wicked Babylon to punish people that are more righteous than they are, more righteous than themselves? He starts off by reviewing the character of God. God, you are eternal. You are the Holy One. You are the righteous judge. You are too pure to even look on evil. And so, God, how in the world can you look on the treacherous evils of Babylon and use them to judge Judah? Yes, Judah is sinful, but nothing like Babylon. How can you use them, God? How can a righteous judge mete out judgment through such an unrighteous nation? Let's put it in terms we might understand better today. Today it would be kind of like God using Russia or China or North Korea or Iran to judge America. Could that happen? We know America is sinful. But how could God use nations like them? They don't even believe in God. They're atheistic. Their whole philosophy is atheism or idolatrous. They persecute the church. They execute Christians for their faith. They are the most abusive of human rights. They burn churches. They burn Bibles. And they're not only enemies of America, they're enemies of you, God. How can you use them to judge us? That's kind of what Habakkuk is saying here. How can you use wicked Babylon to punish people more righteous than they are, than them? So God explains a little more in chapter 2, verse 2 on down through the end of the chapter. Let's read just the first few verses and then we'll discuss it. "Then the Lord replied, 'Write down the revelation, make it plain on tablets so that a herald may run with it.'" In other words, I want everybody to hear this. "For the revelation awaits an appointed time. It speaks of the end and will not prove false, though it linger, wait for it. It will certainly come and will not delay. See, he is puffed up. His desires are not upright, but the righteous will live by his faith. Indeed, wine betrays him. He is arrogant, never at rest, because he is greedy as the grave. And like death, is never satisfied. He gathers to himself all the nations and takes captive all the peoples. Let's stop there. What is God's answer to Habakkuk? God's answer is basically that I know Babylon is sinful, and Babylon is going to also be judged for their sin. He says, I know who is evil, I know who is godly, and ultimately I will punish the wicked, and I will bless the righteous. I will mete out judgment at the appointed time. Notice particularly verse 4. There's quite a contrast here in verse 4. It says, see, he is puffed up. His desires are not upright. That's Babylon. She is puffed up. She's arrogant. She's proud. And that's what leads to all of their violence and their brutality. But in contrast to that, the righteous will live by his faith. And so God draws a stark contrast between the wicked and the faithful. The first is a description of Babylon. They're puffed up, full of pride, which leads to ungodly desires and a lust for power and control and conquest and greed. But then he says, but the righteous will live by faith. Now, what's the opposite of faith? We often think that the opposite of faith is doubt, right? But in this passage, the opposite of faith is pride. Pride. Because our pride will keep us from God. Pride will lead us to believe that we are in control of our own lives. We are in control of our destiny. But the godly place their trust in God rather than in their own wisdom and their own strength. Now, what I want you to see here, what I want you to know is that this verse is a very familiar verse. I'm sure you've heard it before. Because it's repeated three times in the New Testament. In Romans chapter 1, verse 17, Galatians 3, verse 11, and Hebrews 10, verse 38. We as Christians are not to live by sight. We are not to trust in our own strength, our own power, our own wisdom, but we are to live by faith in God. Day by day, moment by moment. Faith isn't just about salvation. Faith is about the daily life that we live as Christians. So we're to live by faith. The just will live, the righteous will live by faith. Well, God goes on in verses 6 through 20 and it kind of taunts the Babylonians for their arrogance. And we find here five different woes. Beware, Babylon. Your day is coming. Your judgment is coming. The tables will soon be turned on Babylon. And Babylon will reap what they sow. So let's just walk through these five. You can read all the verses. I'll just highlight a couple of things. The first is a woe against plundering. In verses 6 through 8, woe to him who piles up stolen goods and makes himself wealthy by extortion. Verse 8, because you have plundered many nations, the peoples who are left will plunder you. See, as the Babylonians marched onward in conquest across that part of the world, they destroyed cities, they killed people, and they plundered their wealth and spoils. Besides their arrogance and their lust for power, they were greedy. Beware, God says, because someday Babylon, you yourselves, will be plundered by someone else. Which came true with the Medes and the Persians. Then he says in verses 9 through 11, woe against injustice. Woe to him who builds his realm by unjust gain to set his nest on high. They plotted and schemed against other nations. Their pride, their greed led them to exploit and abuse and accrue unjust gain from other people. Woe against injustice. Verses 12 through 14, woe against their violence. Verse 12 says, woe to him who builds a city with bloodshed and establishes a town by crime. See, the Babylonians built their empire through violence and bloodshed. They just went through the land and they just wiped out every city in their path. And they killed people and they took them captive. Like the Assyrians before them, they were brutal and they were cruel. They had no regard whatsoever for life. And he says in verses 15 through 17, woe against their immorality. Woe to him who gives drink to his neighbors, pouring it from the wineskin till they are drunk so they can gaze on their naked bodies. You would be filled with shame instead of glory. They sought pleasure, their own pleasure, at the expense of others. They give people drink. They get them drunk. Then after they're drunk, they take advantage of them, exposing their nakedness, probably engaging in sexual immorality and raping some of their victims. That was pretty common in battle those days. Woe against your immorality. What's interesting is that it was later turned, the tables were turned, and it was while the Babylonian leaders were having a party and were drunk that the Medes and Persians came in and overthrew Babylon. Then finally, there's a woe against idolatry. Verses 18 through 28. What value is an idol since a man has carved it? Or an image that teaches lies? For he who makes it trusts in his own creation. He makes idols that cannot speak. Woe to him who says to wood, come to life. Or a lifeless stone, wake up. Can it give guidance? We think not. No way. God demonstrates the futility of the Babylonian polytheism. They worship many gods. They create idols by their own hands. They expect them to come alive and to give them guidance and victory. You know, it's kind of like looking at that communion table saying, table, wood, come alive. We're going to pray to that table and that table's going to answer us. I don't think so. Who's greater? The creator, the craftsman that made the table, or the table itself? Certainly, it can't be turned into a god. And so in sharp contrast to the idolatry of the Babylonians, we read in verse 20, but the Lord is in his holy temple. Yahweh is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before him. God is still alive. God is still in his holy temple. God answers Habakkuk and says, yes, I know about Babylon's sin, and Babylon will also be judged someday for their sins. Yes, God is going to use Babylon to judge Judah, the sins of Judah, but God knows how wicked they are, and God will someday turn the tables on them. Their day is coming. In fact, it was the Medes and the Persians who overthrew the Babylonians less than a century later, in Daniel's day. So I would simply suggest to you that when you wonder, you look around at all the evil and the suffering in the world today and you wonder, where is God in all of this? Be assured, God sees it all. God knows every single bit of it. And he will, in fact, judge at the appointed time, in his time. And that brings us to chapter 3, Habakkuk's prayer of praise. Chapter 3. He starts off with a prayer for mercy. A prayer of Habakkuk the prophet on Shigionath. I don't know what that is. We'll move on. He prays, Lord, I have heard of your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds, O Lord. Renew them in our day. In our time, make them known. In wrath, remember mercy. I think it was the thought of God in his holy temple at the end of chapter 2 that moves Habakkuk to pray and focus on God. He stands in awe of God in his holy temple. He remembers the great, the awesome work of God in the nation of Israel. He understands God's wrath and God's judgment. And as he understands that, he pleads with God for mercy on Judah's behalf. With a grieving heart, Habakkuk urges God to be compassionate, to be merciful, even in the coming wrath on Judah. A prayer for mercy. It behooves us as Christians to pray for mercy on our nation as well, wouldn't it? And then in verses 3 through 16, I'm going to let you read that. We read Habakkuk's praise for God's majesty. He focuses on just what a great and awesome God he is. There's In this section, he focuses on the greatness, the majesty. God is the creator. He's the Lord of heaven and earth. He's holy. He's sovereign. He's a God of wrath who judges the world, but he's also Israel's redeemer. And then he concludes the chapter in the book with a tremendous proclamation of faith in God. Verses 17 through 19. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vine, so the olive crop fails, and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord, Yahweh. I will be joyful in God my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to go on the heights. What a tremendous proclamation of faith and worship in God. Basically, he says here, no matter what happens, even as God judges Judah through the nation of Babylon, I will continue to rejoice in the Lord. When life is great, I can rejoice in a God who is good. He's my Savior. When life stinks, and sometimes life stinks, doesn't it? I can still rejoice in a great and awesome God. Even though I don't understand what God is doing, I can still rejoice. And even when God brings judgment, Habakkuk is secure in the assurance that God was in charge of everything, working all things out in accordance with his perfect will. Do we have that kind of faith in God? With the election this week, you have that kind of faith in God? Will you trust God with whatever the outcome? No matter who wins, God is not surprised. He is still in control. And no matter who wins, you can trust that God is working out his perfect plan. We may not understand his plan, but we can trust that he is working out his perfect plan. And no matter who wins, God is still a great God, and God is still good. He's good all the time. So, how does this apply to us today? Well, we talked about some applications all the way through, but let me just suggest a couple of applications for you. And I don't even think they're on the screen here. But basically, first application is that God can use anything or anyone at any time to fulfill his purposes. God can use anyone or anything at any time to fulfill his purposes. Just as God used Assyria to bring judgment on Israel and the wicked Babylonians to judge Judah, he can still use anything. He can use hurricanes, fires, pandemics, and he can use anyone. Donald Trump, Joe Biden, Vladimir Putin, you can name a few others in there, to fulfill his ultimate purposes in the world at any time. We may not know God's timing, but we can be sure that he is in control. The second application is simply this: no matter what happens, we as Christians must continue to live by faith in a just God. He is great and he is good. So no matter what happens this week, as Christians, we are called to continue to live out our faith in an ungodly world. We are called to be light in a dark world. We can trust in a great and a majestic God. He's sovereign, he's holy, he's righteous and just. And we can trust in a good and loving God. He is gracious, he is merciful, he is compassionate. So let's continue to live by faith, living out our faith, being a light before a dark world. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for a challenging message in Habakkuk. Lord, it's easy for us as believers to have questions, to ask you questions, God. And I just thank you that you answer some of Habakkuk's questions. And in doing so, you reveal to us, again, who you are. A great and awesome God, a majestic God, a God who is just, a God who is holy, a God who is merciful, a God who is gracious. Lord, I just pray that each one of us here in this church will continue to live by faith, day by day, moment by moment. I pray these things in Jesus' name.